Good morning, church. I want to extend to you a warm welcome to our Sunday morning worship here at Scarborough Community Alliance Church. Church, we are made to worship God, to be reminded of his goodness and grace to us. And I know it's not always easy to be active participants on Sunday mornings. Many of us are distracted, discouraged, or tired. For me, the last couple of weeks have been just exhausting and draining. And recently, I've been introduced to a new term, languishing. That is a sense of feeling joyless, aimless, especially in light of the pandemic that we are living in. There are times when it feels like things are just blah or monotonous. You may be feeling this too. But church, the Lord encouraged me through Isaiah 40 in my devotional time. And it says, "Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel? My way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youths shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles, and they shall run and not be faint. They shall walk and not faint." I was reminded that despite this feeling, we have assurance through the eternal joy and hope in Jesus Christ. We have a Lord who gives us strength and zeal. He fights for us. He gives us new life, and that is what we should live for. So church, let us hold on to this truth. And let us call upon the Lord and worship him wherever you are. Come, just as you are. Brothers and sisters, will you join us as we enter his presence and have a fresh encounter with God this morning? Let us not be faint or grow weary, but let the Lord renew our strength, for he is our everlasting God.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong.
You're the defender of the weak.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, there is none like you. We give you thanks and praise, for you are our rock in whom we take refuge. You are our shield, our stronghold. Lord, forgive us of the times where we have fallen short and turned away from you. In these times of monotony and aimlessness, may you breathe into us and give us joy and peace. Thank you that we have a restored relationship with you because of the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And as we approach you with open palms and heart, may we offer our lives to you, a living sacrifice. May we be ambassadors for Christ, that we may be the bearers of good news. Lord, may you reign in us.
You thought of us before the world began to breathe. You knew our names before we came to be. You saw the very day we fall away from you. How desperately we need to be redeemed. Lord Jesus, come lead. lost in darkest night, yet thought I knew the way, the sin that promised joy and life had led me to the grave. I had no home that you would own, a rebel to your will. And if you had not loved me first, I would refuse you
Church. Let us join together in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, God, the psalmist writes, "The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my rock in whom I take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold." We pray for forgiveness in our weakness when we turn to our own strengths rather than taking refuge in you, rather than turning to you as our shield, salvation, and stronghold. We resort to our power and human failings. We pray for thanksgiving in the broader distribution of the COVID vaccine to the community. We pray for wisdom and compassion for the decision makers and authorities in Ontario and Canada for the COVID response. We pray for those among us who are suffering in sickness and in pain. We pray for your spirit of healing to ease the pain and to heal the illness. We look and pray for peace around the world, especially between Israel and Hamas in the Gaza Strip. Lord, we pray for the international workers around the world. We pray for their safety and their spiritual strength to sharing the good news of your saving grace. We pray all this in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Good morning, church. My name is Phoebe. Today's scripture reading comes from John 16, verses 16 to 33. A little while, and you will see me no longer. And again a little while, and you will see me. So some of his disciples said to one another, "What is this that he says to us? A little while and you will not see me, and again a little while and you will see me, and because I'm going to the Father?" So they were saying, "What does he mean by a little while? We do not know what he is talking about." Jesus knew that they wanted to ask him. So he said to them, "Is this what you are asking yourselves? What I meant by saying, 'A little while and you will not see me, and again a little while and you will see me'? Truly, truly, I say to you, you will weep and lament, but the world will rejoice. You will be sorrowful, but your sorrow will turn into joy. When a woman is giving birth, she has sorrow because her hour has come, but when she has delivered a baby, she no longer remembers the anguish for joy that a human being has been born into the world. So also, you have sorrow now, but I will see you again, and your hearts will rejoice, and no one will take your joy from you. In that day, you will ask nothing of me. Truly, truly, I say to you, whatever you ask of the Father in my name, he will give it to you. Until now, you have asked nothing in my name. Ask, and you will receive, that your joy may be full. I have said these things to you in figures of speech. The hour is coming when I will no longer speak to you in figures of speech, but will tell you plainly about the Father. In that day, you will ask in my name, and I do not say to you that I will ask the Father on your behalf. For the Father himself loves you, because you have loved me and have believed that I came from God. I came from the Father and have come into the world, and now I am leaving the world and going to the Father." His disciples said, "Now you're speaking plainly and not using figurative speech. Now we know that you know all things and do not need anyone to question you. This is why we believe that you came from God." Jesus answered them, "Do you now believe? Behold, the hour is coming. Indeed, it has come, when you will be scattered, each to his own home, and will leave me alone. Yet I'm not alone, for the Father is with me. I have said these things to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but take heart, I have overcome the world." May God bless the reading of his word.
Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to our service today. For those of you who may not know, we had a wedding here in the church sanctuary. So congratulations to Calvin and to Melody. Calvin is the volunteer. He's head of our AV department here in the church, and he and Melody got married yesterday at the church here. It was so weird because we only were allowed to have 10 people at a maximum in the sanctuary here. Well, all the best to you, Calvin and Melody, and congratulations. Well, it wasn't very long ago that there was a lot of snow. It was cold, it was freezing, and I can still remember not too long ago, one of GTA's worst winter storms in a long time. It hit GTA and it was really, really bad. I remember that day vividly because I had to go pick up my wife Joyce and daughter at the bus stop just down the street from our house. And I had to pick them up around, I think it was 4 o'clock or something like that. And I got into the car and made my way down and was going to pick them up at the gate, but it was about a foot and a half of snow on the road that led to the gate. So I knew I couldn't make it in, so I stopped and just parked right there, maybe about a block away. And I remember waiting for them to come, and this lady in this older domestic car, it was a rear-wheel drive car, it was pretty big, she tried to go in. And just within a few feet of going into that street, she got stuck. She couldn't go. She just sat there and spun her tires for maybe about 15 or 20 minutes or so. I mean, a foot and a half of snow. There was no way she was going to make it. And so Joyce and my daughter finally came. They're walking through the snow on the road, and as they got to my car, I finally had felt like I could help this lady. So I asked her if I could take her car, and and try to move it out for her. And she says, sure, be my guest, sir. And so I got in, and within about 2 minutes, rocking back and forth really slowly, 1 inch at a time, finally, within about 2 minutes, I got her car out of that place where she was stuck. And I just suggested to her, ma'am, maybe you'll want to get some snow tires in the future and try to avoid these big banks like that is on this road. So why do I tell you this story? It's because sometimes we allow ourselves to get stuck. And what I mean by that is that sometimes we get stuck on our fears or our hurts or our bitterness, some emotional traumatic event that we can't seem to shake away from. You see, it's easy to be blinded from the freedom and the joy that could be ours if we would only see beyond ourselves and our hurt feelings and being stuck on certain things in life. I mean, I think that's why people hold grudges, and a lot of times that's why people have hostilities towards other people. And so many of us, including myself, we keep replaying those events of hurt over and over and over again. And sometimes it goes on for many, many years. And even though someone really close to us may give us a solution and a fix on how to get unstuck, we're unable to hear any solution because we're so fixated on our hurts and our feelings and our emotional trauma. Everybody else can see how to get unstuck, but not the person that's fixated on the things that they are feeling inside. As we come to John chapter 16, it's a story that continues in our sermon series in the book of John. And in John chapter 16, where we come to today, I mean, this may be the very thing that is going on with the disciples of Jesus here. His disciples seem to be stuck in their fears and in their worries. And when they are stuck with their fears, how can anybody experience the joy that God intends for us to have? And I think that when we call ourselves a Christian and we have no joy in our lives, I mean, we could be the most pitied people on this earth. Why? Because Jesus promises that for those who follow Him, we will be full of joy. And so when we lack joy and show nothing but hostilities and hurt and displeasure, and we never are able to smile, I mean, really, we should be more pitied than anybody else on this earth. So in our sermon series in the book of John, the book of John is all about Jesus Christ. He is God in human flesh. Do you believe? That's the theme that emerges out of the Gospel of John. You'll remember in John chapter 14, Jesus Himself said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Nobody comes to the Father except through me. And really, at the beginning of the upper room discourse that began in John chapter 14, Jesus told His disciples that He was going to leave them and He's going to go away. Of course, Jesus is talking about going away to be put to death, but they didn't realize that. And so the disciples are so worried after 3 to 3.5 years of Jesus being with them, He's now going to leave them. And they are worried sick about Him leaving and going away. And it is very obvious that they are stuck and worried to sick in John chapter 14, in John chapter 15, and in John chapter 16 that we'll look at today. They are stuck and worried sick because Jesus is going away. They cannot see beyond themselves in their worry and their fear. So let's turn to John chapter 16 now. And our text today is actually verses 16 to 33. But I want to just look back a few verses and put this into context at the beginning of chapter 16. So look with me at verses 5 to 7. This is what Jesus says in John chapter 16, verses 5 to 7. But now I am going to Him who sent me, and none of you ask me, where are you going? But because I have said these things to you, sorrow has filled your heart. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage and your blessing that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper, talking about the Holy Spirit, the Helper will not come to you. But if I go away, I will send Him to you, disciples. Jesus here is talking about sending the Holy Spirit to the disciples, but he has to go away first before he can do that. And Jesus, in many ways, laments because these disciples here that are following here, they were so preoccupied and fixated on their own insecurities of being without Jesus. They weren't even, they didn't show much concern about where are you going, Jesus? Not really, about his immediate future. The next few days in the life of Jesus, according to the plan of God, would be totally amazing. Jesus' journey to the cross, Jesus' journey to his crucifixion and death, Jesus' immediate future, the next few days in the plan of God, it's going to change the course of human history forever and ever. It's huge. God was about to inaugurate the age of grace, the beginning and the birth of the New Testament church, and the spread of the gospel to the very ends of this earth. But were Jesus' disciples interested in all of that? No, they weren't. Not really. Zero. It says in verse 6 that they had sorrow had filled their hearts. And this word sorrow in the Greek means deep, deep pain. Pain had filled the disciples' hearts because all they could think about, all that they were fixated on, was the fact that Jesus was leaving them, and they were worried, sick to their stomachs about it. And then in John chapter, in this passage, in this section, in 16, verses 5 to 15, Jesus tries to encourage his disciples by telling them about the Holy Spirit, what Jesus would send to them, the Comforter, to comfort their hearts. And it would be the Holy Spirit that would convict the world of sin and righteousness and judgment. And he, the Holy Spirit, would guide the disciples into all truth. All truth that Jesus gave to these disciples. And at this point, the disciples should be jumping up and down, happy and filled with joy, because Jesus is going away, but he's not really leaving them alone. But all they could do in this section is to be stuck in their worries and in their fears and insecurities. They should be filled with joy, but all they can see is doom and gloom in their lives because Jesus would not be with them. And so that brings us up to our section, John chapter 16, verses 16 to 33. And what we see in this section is Jesus is using a formula, which he uses in the chapter 16 here. He gives a sad prediction, a very sad thing. And he uses this formula, a sad prediction, and then a celebrative promise. That's what Jesus does. He gives them something almost discouraging, but then he gives them something, the way out, the fix, and they should be jumping up and down by it, a celebrative promise following his sad prediction. So let's look at chapter 16. We're looking at verses 16 to 24, just for the first section here. 16 to 24. A little while, Jesus says, and you will see me no longer. And again, a little while, and you will see me. So some of the disciples said to one another, what? Is this that he says to us? What is this that he says to us? A little while, you will see me. You will not see me. And a little while, you will see me. And because I am going to the Father. So they were saying, what does he mean by a little while? We do not know what he is talking about. Jesus knew that they wanted to ask him, so he said to them, is this what you are asking among yourselves? What I mean by saying a little while and you will not see me, and again a little while and you will see me? Truly, truly, I say to you, you will weep and lament, but the world will rejoice. You will be sorrowful, but your sorrow will turn into joy. When a woman is giving birth, she has sorrow because her hour has come. But when she has delivered the baby, she no longer remembers the anguish for joy that a human being has been born into the world. So also, you have sorrow now, but I will see you again and your hearts will rejoice, and no one will take your joy from you. In that day, you will ask nothing of me. Truly, truly, I say to you, whatever you ask of my Father in my name, he will give to you. Until now, you have asked nothing in my name. Ask, and you will receive, that your joy may be full. Let's notice that Jesus uses this sad prediction here that's followed by a celebrative promise. When he says in verse 16, in a bit, you won't see me. And then in a bit, you will see me. Jesus is really talking to them and telling them and informing them about his upcoming arrest and his trial and his death and his crucifixion in the next few days. It's so sad, so very, very sad. But then in a bit, Jesus says, that's the celebrative promise. He says, then in a bit, you will see me. He's talking about and prophesying and promising about his resurrection. But in verses 17 and 18, disciples are they're confused. They don't know what to make about all of this. They don't understand what Jesus is talking about. This figurative language that Jesus is using seems almost meaningless and confusing to them. So Jesus uses his formula again in verses 20 to 24, and he gives them this sad prediction that they will weep, that they will weep and lament in this world and while the world rejoices. I mean, look at verse 20 here. Jesus says, truly, truly, I say to you, you will weep and lament, but the world will rejoice. You will be sorrowful, but your sorrow will turn into joy. What's Jesus saying here? What does Jesus mean here? Jesus here predicts that all disciples here would experience intense sorrow because of Jesus' death. And yes, yes, that's true. They're going to be sorrowful at his crucifixion. They're going to be sorrowful at his burial and all of that. And when Jesus is put to death here, the world is celebrating. At least the world that is filled with darkness, they'll be celebrating, thinking that they've won the war. During this time that Jesus is talking about, Jesus actually comes back alive. It's his resurrection. And Jesus promises to come back in the end of days. And so it's a realization to us that all Christians are going to experience sorrow in this life on earth. Loved ones will die. Diseases will spread. People will become sick. COVID and all of its double and triple and quadruple variants are going to cause all kinds of pain and anguish in this church age. But there will be all kinds of traumatic events and diseases everywhere. And innocent people and loved ones, they will suffer. They will be ill. But meanwhile, it'll look like to the malicious people that or at least to Satan in the darkness, they've won. Jesus Christ is dead. That is, until Jesus rises from the dead and until Jesus comes back for his second return. Jesus' delightful promise here, and he says five times in five verses, he talks about the joy that all followers will have. Look with me at verses 20 to 24 here, five verses, five times Jesus talks about the joy. Verse 20, Jesus says, truly, truly, I say to you, you will weep and lament, but the world will rejoice. You will be sorrowful, but your sorrow will turn into joy. When a woman is giving birth, she has sorrow because her hour has come. But when she has delivered a baby, she no longer remembers the anguish for joy that a human being has been born into the world. So also you have sorrow now, but I will see you again and your hearts will rejoice. No one will take your joy from you. In that day, you will ask nothing of me. Truly, truly, I say to you, whatever you ask of my Father in my name, he will give to you. Until now, you will have asked nothing in my name. Ask, and you will receive, that your joy may be full. Jesus will be vindicated at the resurrection. And Jesus will again, or at least his church will again, be vindicated at his return at the end of the age. But let's not get stuck in our time of pain and our time of sorrow and our time of anguish. Friends, even when bad things happen to good and innocent people, let's not get stuck, but let us all look to Jesus Christ with all joy, because we know the truth and we know the future. Jesus Christ will rise from the dead, and Jesus Christ will come back at the end of the age to make all things right and all things just. I tell you, friends, I mean, we must have faith, and we are invited to have trust, and we must have an openness to the Word of God if we are to be unstuck. Because when we get unstuck from our worries and fears and hostilities, I mean, the kind of joy that God wants us to have can fill our souls and give us the kind of joy that only God can give. One of the ways to get unstuck, if we want to be practical, I mean, the clue is given in verses 23 to 24. So take a look with me at verses 23 and 24. How to get unstuck from our pain and sorrow. Verse 23, in that day you will ask nothing of me. Truly, truly, I say to you, whether you ask of my Father in my name, he will give it to you. Whatever you ask in my Father's name, he will give it to you. Until now, you have asked nothing in my name. Ask, and you will receive, that your joy may be full. And what is clear here is that we need to cultivate an intimate personal relationship with the Heavenly Father through a life of prayer. And when we ask things of God, because we are in His will and His words are in us, and we ask things that are aligned with the will and the plan of God, we can be sure that God will answer those prayers that are in His will, that are aligned with Him, that are rooted in His Word, that will bring Him glory. God will answer those prayers for His glory. And so, friends, I mean, intimacy with God has to be grounded in a life of prayer and communication to the Heavenly Father. And that's the road and the path to experience the greatest amount of joy in our lives on this earth. Why? Because before Jesus' death and resurrection, the people of God had to go through a priest to be able to communicate with God. But now, we no longer have to go through a priest, because as soon as Jesus Christ rose from the dead, He gave us direct access to the Heavenly Father. Amazing. Amazing. When Jesus Christ resurrected from the dead, He defeated death and darkness and Satan and sin. And He gave all Christians immediate access directly to the Heavenly Father. Can you imagine that? That we humans can have direct access to the sovereign creator of this entire universe. What greater joy could we ever experience on this earth than to have a way back directly to God? It's most amazing what Jesus has done for us. The result of intimacy with God in prayer is having a joy to its fullest measure. That's the first sorrowful prediction that's followed by the celebrative promise. We should be filled with joy, not filled with worrisome feelings that prevent us from experiencing God. And so they were to experience intense sorrow and pain for sure, but the promise of of this joy can never be taken away unless we allow it to be taken away. But anyways, there is a second sorrowful or sad prediction that Jesus gives, but he follows it with a celebrative promise in verses 25 to 28. So if you take a look together, look at with me at verses 25 to 28. Jesus continues in verse 25, "I have said these things to you in figures of speech. The hour is coming when I will no longer speak to you in figures of speech, but will tell you plainly about the Father. In that day you will ask in my name, and I do not say to you that I will ask the Father on your behalf, for the Father himself loves you because you have loved me and believe that I came from God. I came from the Father and have come into the world, and now I am leaving the world and going to the Father." Wow, here is a sad prediction that Jesus is going away and he's no longer going to speak to them in figures of speech, but he's going to speak plainly about the Heavenly Father. And what is the celebrative promise for the disciples? The celebrative promise is all about the love of the Father for his disciples. Look again at verses 26 to 28. "In that day you will ask in my name, and I do not say to you that I will ask the Father on your behalf, for the Father himself loves you." Did you get it? For the Father himself loves you because you have loved me and have believed that I came from God. I came from the Father and have come into the world, and now I am leaving the world and going back to the Father. And so that's the promise. It's celebrative. It's all about the love of the Father for the followers of Jesus Christ. And then in the verses 31 to 33, we see a third part of his formula, a sad prediction followed by a celebrative promise. Look at verses 31 to 33. Verse 31, "Jesus answered them, 'Do you now believe? Behold, the hour is coming. Indeed, it has come. When you will be scattered, each to his own home, and will leave me alone. Yet I am not alone, for the Father is with me. I have said these things to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but take heart, disciples, I have overcome the world.'" Here, the sad prediction is that all the disciples would be scattered, and they would be chased out of their homes, and they would be chased out of their cities, and they will all abandon Jesus and leave Jesus, abandon him and leave Jesus to himself. That's the disheartening truth that actually took place in the days of Jesus and his disciples. But what's the delightful promise here? It's in verse 33. Verse 33 tells us that Jesus Christ isn't really alone. The Heavenly Father is with him. And in verse 32, I mean, that's what it said. Jesus leaves these celebrative promises with them. So what? So that they might have peace from God. In this world that's full of trials and tribulations and sicknesses, they might have the peace that comes from God into their hearts. Jesus says, take heart, be at peace. Why? Because Jesus says, I have overcome the world. Jesus has overcome the world. It's a beautiful promise. It's celebrative. And this morning I ask you, friends, have you ever been so preoccupied with your own hurts and your own failures or your own fears that you could not think of anything else because you were fixated on your hurts and on your failures? I mean, to be honest with you, I have a person in my own life that I don't think any of you have ever met before, but our checkered relationship goes back many, many years and even many decades because there were so many hurts and misunderstandings before. And I'm sure that every time the name of this person came up in a conversation between my wife Joyce and I, I'm sure that I retold her every bad thing that this person ever did and how I blame this person for all of these bad things and all of these bad misunderstandings. And I really believe that I've told these same lousy beefs that I carried in my heart to my wife over and over and over and over again. For me, I can't tell you how many times I've replayed all of those hurts, how many times I was just so fixated on how that person was to blame because that person did this, 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 and this. And every time I replay those tapes, it gets me even more angry. I would defend myself in my mind and accept no responsibility and no fault. It was always that other person's lousy at being at fault, so stuck and unable to move forward. And I don't think it was until, I mean, when we think about getting unstuck, it wasn't until I was able to see beyond my hostilities and beyond my hate and beyond how in the future this sibling in Christ, I mean, this person would be in the presence of God with all other brothers and sisters in Christ. I mean, when I came to see that we were on the same team, that we were in the same family, that we were all children of God together, and that in the new heavens and the new earth, we would all be there worshiping Jesus Christ together. I mean, oh my, that's why I think when I was able to see that person to be with me and the rest of Christendom, in the new heavens and the new earth, I can finally go, pew, and brush away any hurts and any failures and any blame that I may have unjustly placed at that person's feet. All the hours and all the breath remaining that I have on this earth, I'm able to brush my hurts and my fixations away, because I mean, let's be real here. Let me not fool myself. I may not be the BBF with this person that has hurt me so much, but I promise you, we can sit at the table and eat together, and we can respect each other, and we can have a relationship once again. I was able to become unstuck and able to discover joy once again when I got myself out of my own way and was able to see the vision of how we would be related in the future of God's kingdom. That's when, my friends, I was able to discover joy once again. And so I ask you this morning, do you lack joy in your life on this earth? Have you found it difficult to feel loved or to experience true peace because of extenuating circumstances and trials and tribulations and sickness in this world? Because if that's where you or I are at, I mean, it might be time to stop focusing on ourselves and our hurts and our troubles and to focus on Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone. My, if we would all only be able to focus on Jesus and to draw close to God, let us, friends, let us, brothers, let us, sisters, let us all learn not to be fixated on our own hurts and troubles, but let us embrace Jesus Christ and to learn to dwell on His promises and on His solutions and on His way. Jesus said in John chapter 14, verse 6, He said, "I am the way and the truth and the life. Nobody comes to the Father and gets unstuck except through me, Jesus Christ." Let's close in prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for Jesus. How could we ever survive without Jesus? We would be without direct access to you. And so on this day, God, I pray you would help us to experience all the joy in its full measure that you intend for all of us as children of God to have, because we have saw fit to see beyond ourselves and our failures and our hurts, and to see Jesus Christ, the one who died for us and gave access to you, our Heavenly Father. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Victor, for your message this morning. Let us join together and sing, "How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me." Let's join and sing, "How marvelous."
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Love in Action's announcements. I just want to again thank you all for always being so eager in participating with all the initiatives that we've done thus far. I know it's been a busy past few months. Like in April, we had outreach with Out of the Cold. We had missions through Christie Refugee Center with our Easter baskets. May, our words of encouragement cards that went out to Rouge Valley, Chartwell Rouge Valley Retirement Residence. And so coming up in June, the worship ministry is taking on the first part of the Love in Action. And really, we just want to bless you with a live stream worship event. And this is to celebrate us as a church together, celebrate God's goodness as we have our anniversary on June 6th. So more details to follow, but we will have a live stream worship service on June 6th in the evening. We will give you more details as we iron out how we can best do this. So before we go on with the rest of our announcements, I just want to show you some pictures of where the cards went to and some of the people that received the cards. So here are some of the pictures. So June 26th is Men's Day at SCOM. I really want to encourage all our men here at SCOM to join in. And of course, you're more than welcome to invite non-SCOM friends to come and join. And next week, you'll be hearing from the men who are organizing this event of what to expect for that day. But I just want you to mark down on your calendars that this day is a special day set aside for the men here at SCOM. So thank you for listening to this announcement.
Well, thank you, Eileen, for those announcements. We greatly appreciate it. And now let us bow our heads and close in prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, we are grateful for the joy that comes from heaven above. It is a different joy from the joy that this world experiences, because it is a joy that comes from the heart of God. And you've made that available to all of us through Jesus Christ. So we thank you for that. May you help us to truly focus on Jesus and your joy. And now may the God of all grace, who has called us to his eternal glory in Christ, may he himself restore and confirm and strengthen and establish all of us. To him be the glory and dominion forever and ever. And all of God's people say together, amen, amen. Well, thank you for inviting us into your homes. I pray that you will have a blessed week to come because of your openness to God and his glory. Amen. We'll see you the next time around.